Welcome, and thank you for joining us here at Commitment Online, a place for all nations. We want you to fully engage with us, so feel free to gather your family, invite a friend, or if you're alone, we trust that you'll have a wonderful worship experience with us today. Our worship service will begin in just a few minutes. Thank you.
We've come for a move of God. We've come for the Holy One. All we want, all we hunger is for you. We've come with expectant hearts, undone, knowing who you are, Lord. We long for what only you can do. Holy Spirit, come like fire in the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We're gonna stay here until we encounter you. Make us an offering, make us an upper room. We're gonna stay here until we encounter you. Till we encounter you. Make us desperate, tear our idols down. We're repentant, this is still your house. Yes, you meant it. Yes, you said you'd pour your spirit out. So we sing, come Holy Spirit. Fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We're gonna stay here until we encounter you. Make us an offering, make us an upper room. We're gonna stay until we encounter you. Until we encounter you. Until we encounter you. We thank you, Jesus. We say, we need a move of God. We need a move of God. We need a move of God. We're hungry, we're desperate. Oh Lord, open the heavens. We until we encounter fire, fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We're gonna stay here until we encounter you. Make us an offering,
make us an offering.
We're gonna stay here until we encounter you. An upper room, we're gonna stay here till we count. We need a move, we need a move of God. We need a move of God, yes, we do. We need a move of God, Lord. We are, we're desperate. ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Thank you for showing me your love in every circumstance of my life. Oh, you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Chief cornerstone, no other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man, all other ground is seen. Upon this rock, you build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. When we
one more time, just echo it with us in this place. Say, upon this rock, you build your church, and the gates of heaven. Build your church. Build your church.
Build your church. Build your church. Build it from the ground up. It's your church. Build your church. Build your church. Build it from the ground up.
Build your church.
Build your church. Build your church. Build it from the ground up. It's your church.
So much for the finished work of Jesus. We thank you that we are part of the church that you're building, and upon the rock of Christ and Christ alone is on which we stand and which we exist throughout all eternity. So Father, I pray now that you would help me help your people, help us to understand who we are as the ecclesia, the called out ones, the body of Christ, so that we may be fully equipped to grow in you deeper, so that we can go wherever you have designed us to go as a church, individually as well as collectively. So Father, I need your help. So please remove the hindrances and barriers that may be in my heart that will hinder what you want to accomplish today. And I pray the same for your people, that you would just settle their hearts, let the word of God fall on good ground and bear much fruit. In the magnificent name of Jesus Christ, we all say amen. As a reminder, if you're just jumping on board with us with the sermon series, this word ecclesiology is a big theological word, and it simply means that it is applied to, as relates to theology, the nature, structure, and purpose of the Christian church, which is the body of Christ. Thus is the analytical study of its form and practices. But what we need to also understand and remember is that the church is not a place or a building. The church is the people, it's you and me. The church, the word church comes from a Greek word, ekklesia, which means the called out ones, those who are separated by and through the finished work of Jesus Christ. Thus, those of us who have put our faith and trust in the finished work of Jesus, the church, we're called to be light, salt, sweet smell and aroma in a dark, smelly, dying world. We are this remnant that has a responsibility to share the good news of Jesus Christ to a dark and dying world. So during this series, we've been striving to grow deeper in our relationship with Christ as the church, and thus be more prepared or better prepared to go wherever he's assigned us to go, however far-reaching and strategic he has assigned for us as a church to be with the gospel of Jesus Christ, all for his glory into the next generation, even children yet unborn. Children who are sitting in the sanctuary today are ultimately going to be the ones who are leading and guiding this church until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So through this series, we've been answering three important questions. The first is this: what is the nature of the church? We finished that last week. The nature of the church. Now we're diving into the structure of the church. What is the structure of the church and why it's so important to understand how the church is structured? And then lastly, we'll dive into what is the purpose of the church. There's some clear purposes of the church that will never, ever change on this side of heaven. So if you could open to one of my favorite passages of scriptures, and that is Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, we're going to read verses 1 through 18, and then we're going to answer the question as it relates to the structure of the church and who is the head of the church in verses 13 and maybe about 18. So as you turn in there, to answer the big question of the structure of the church, there's about four important details we're going to navigate through. The first is the head of the church, which we're going to cover today. The second is the body. What is the body's function and structure? What is the leadership structure of the church? And also, what are the ordinances, such as baptism, communion? Why are they in place? Why do we do what we do? Now, some of you may be thinking, okay, why are we going into all this granial detail as relates to the ecclesia, as relates to the church? Well, this is important because as God is moving rapidly in your life and the life of this church, it's super important that we have a sure foundation and our roots are deep in understanding of who we really, really, really are, as opposed to what we think we are and what the world says the church is today. Amen? So again, Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, who is the head of the church? Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ who are at Colossae. Remember, we learned early on that these letters are written to churches, right? And the letters many times are written by name. And these are epistles. These are books. These, what we call books, but they are epistles, are letters to these particular church. And again, affirming this, Paul is writing to the church at Colossae. He says, grace to you and peace from God our Father. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints, because of the hope reserved for you in heaven, of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel. Now think about that for a minute. As we've been navigating this, there's this responsibility of these things I give to you. You give to faithful few, right? Remember, we're supposed to be men and women who are always growing, right? Always maturing so that we can multiply, so we can always be what? Mobile, on the move, leading by the Holy Spirit. So here you see Paul right away saying, hey, church, and he's going to get deeper. There's people who are sent to you, but you got to keep doing what you've been taught and what you've learned. So he goes on to verse 8, which has come to you, just as in all the world, also it is bearing fruit. You hear that? An increase, even as it has been doing in you also since the day of that you have heard of it, understood the grace of God in truth, just as you learned it from whom? Epaphras, our beloved fellow bondservant, who is a faithful servant of Christ on our behalf, and he also informed us of your love in the Spirit. Verse number 9, for this reason we also, since the day we heard of it, have not ceased praying for you and have asked that you have been filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for the attaining of all perseverance and patience. Now think about this. Does anybody need anything that verses 9 through 11 already described? Right? Like patience, like strength, like fruit, like wisdom and understanding. Guess where it came from? Prayer. See why we always exclaim we need to become a house of prayer? We need to be men and women who pray because we don't know what to do. We don't know how to do it. And the more we engage with the one who knows how to do it, the more we understand how to do it and what to do it. Therefore, there is this importance of that we are strengthened in power according to his glorious might for attaining all perseverance and patience, jealously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. The only way we get there is by fully engaging him. Prayer is not an option, as you see here. But that's a side note. But the head of the church today, who is he? Why is it so important to really understand that, listen, the head of the church isn't me. The head of the church isn't any pastor. The head of the church is no elder, no deacon, no women's leader. The head of the church is nobody we have labeled leaders in the church. None of us, zero, period. And it's super important to really hone in on that and know that, because the greater the platform, the greater of growing, platform increases, deception increases. And we're going to get deeper into this. So when you look at verses 13 through 18, listen to what it says, and we're going to dive into answering this question: who is the church? For he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. What man is capable of doing that? In whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or authorities, our rulers or authorities, of all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also the head of the church, or head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. Why? Why did he do all of this? So that he himself will come to have first place in everything. He didn't just die just to die. He died, he shed his blood to earn the right in our lives and earn the right to be the head of the church. So who is this head? Verse 13 and 14 summarize this way. The head of the church, the ecclesia, is our deliverer. And listen, there's no created person on the face of this planet that can deliver anyone at any time. How do we know this? He rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. This word rescue, you know what it means? To draw to oneself. So literally, when Jesus Christ died, buried, rose again from the grave, he was literally drawing you closer to himself. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 calls it this way. He reconciles us back to himself. And that word reconcile, you know what it is? It is what one would call the pre-Adamic fall state. He created man to fellowship with him. Through his death, through his burial, through his resurrection, through the redemption work, he delivered us to bring us back to himself. To have sweet fellowship with his creation. That's what he wanted to do. So he drew us to himself. He delivered us so that you and I can be his. What pastor has the ability to do that? Truth be told, what pastor has the right to say you are his? That's why I'm always hesitant when people say, well, is that your church? Yeah, I'm also a part of that church. They are not my people. I'm a part of the people, theologically proper. So when you see this and you look at it deeper, it just broadens our perspective to understand that the head of the church is a deliverer, and there's nobody that can deliver anyone but Jesus. He transferred us, he says, which means to remove from a place to another, or here's the best part of that definition, a change of situation. When you came to know Jesus Christ and he delivered you, he changed your situation. Some of you may or may not have experienced that because you haven't, yes, fully embraced and experienced his deliverance for you. And we're going to get deeper into this as he being the deliverer. That he can change your situation. That's the power he possessed as the deliverer of the church within the church, is that you could come become a part of the church through the finished work of Jesus. And you could come into the church with marital difficulties and marital problems and families all fall apart, personally decaying, that you're emotionally just wiped out and can't even sleep at night. He will ultimately deliver you and change your situation, and he can do it supernaturally. I don't care how many times you call a pastor late at night, he cannot change your situation. Only God can. What he should do is point you to the deliverer who can change any situation and any hour of the day. In whom we have redemption. The word redemption means this: we have been released, or this liberation by payment of ransom. We have been delivered. So think about this closely. That there's a ransom that has been paid through the finished work of Jesus. You are in bondage, that you are sold, right, into bondage of slavery. You are in prison, if you would, okay? You have been taken away, if you would, and you're being held ransom. Jesus Christ's finished work as a deliverer paid your ransom once and for all. Cannot be taken back, cannot be repossessed. Payment is made in full. Now, here's the beautiful thing about this, is that when I was growing up, some of you may remember this, there was something called, and they're trying to bring it back, there's something that was called, called layaway. Right, that was before credit cards. Right, every household didn't have credit cards. Matter of fact, I don't even know if credit cards even exist. I'm telling my age. I don't know if credit cards even existed back then. You had a line of credit. Maybe that was it. But there was something called layaway for those who didn't have much money. You go to Kmart, or back then it was Kmart, not Walmart. You go to Kmart, and you say, Mommy, can I have that bike? You say, boy, I can't afford that. Let's put it on layaway. When Jesus Christ paid your ransom, you were not put on layaway. There wasn't this partial payment, because part of layaway was this: if you didn't pay and make the payment by the deadline, you lose everything. Jesus Christ paid the ransom once and for all. And here's the other cool thing. He doesn't say return to sender ever. No matter how complicated your life gets, no matter how defective life gets, or let's say it this way, no matter how defective we become and act, he never says return to sender, because you and I are purchased once and for all. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7 describes Christ's deliverance this way: in him we have redemption, we have deliverance through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. So here's the beautiful part of God's grace through Christ, is that his grace saves you, but his grace also sustains you. You follow me? In other words, those times that we act unbecoming of a Christian, his grace is sufficient. Because the scripture says to you and I, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. Matter of fact, he also says that our righteousness is but as what? Filthy rags. So in our good day, we still need his grace. And that's the grace of God, grace that saves, grace that sustains, even during our most difficult and trying times of our lives. The head of the church is our deliverer. The head of the church also, listen to this, he is our God. Why is that important to know that the head of the church is our God? He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of our creation. So think about this. There is the invisible God, God the Father. Then you have God the Son, whom we are referring to, God the Holy Spirit, right? God the Father, invisible. There's no man who's ever looked and behold the Father. There's no one who's really looked and behold the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit lives within us because of the finished work of Jesus, right? But then this is just like God. We in our humanness many times need substance. So he says, okay, here's the image of myself found in Christ. He is the image of the invisible God. It's beautiful that God knows his creation as the creator and says, well, there's this importance to engage my creation, right? Draw them to myself. Matter of fact, I will go be with them so that they can fully understand me. That's why you see the affirmation of verse 16, for by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. Again, affirming that there's not a man on this face of this planet that can insert themselves as the head of the church. Because there's no man on this planet that has created anything. Even if you are a master creator yourself, you've been gifted knowledge, you've been gifted skill sets, you've been gifted tools, you've been gifted things to mold, to shape, to create yourself. Therefore, not even that has been your creation. Because everything is on loan by the what? Creator of all things. And that's why he is the image of the invisible God. The word image means this: he is the likeness of God. And this is only assigned to Christ on account of his divine nature and his absolute moral excellence. The scripture says this, that we have a great high priest in Christ who can sympathize with our weaknesses, yet without sin. Who can exclaim that? Who can say that I've lived every day of my life sinless, morally excellent? That's nobody can ever do that but Christ and Christ alone. But then you find another key word in this verse 15 and 16 is that all things are created, right? The word created. But then he also says it has also been created through him and for him. The word created means this: to make habitable. He created the earth, heavens and the earth. He made earth habitable by what? Mankind, right? Stay with me. But then he also says that God creating the worlds, he formed it, he shaped it, and completely changed or transformed. Remember the scripture says about you and me this. He says that we are buildings that are made without what? Hands. He also says that we are the temple of God, where his spirit dwells. Before Jesus Christ, his spirit cannot dwell in you. He had to first create you, transform you, so his Holy Spirit can now do what? Live within you. So when you hear the word created, the only person that can change a man in the ecclesia, the church, is God. Wives, you can never change your husband. So stop trying. I know we drive you crazy. Stop trying. Leave it up to the Creator God. Leave it up to the head of the church. Guys, listen. Yes, you would love to change your wife and make her, you know, the Stepford Wives. Anybody remember that? You know, she just does everything you want her to do. No. Stop trying. She is fearfully and wonderfully made. Only God can change her in a way that benefits you. Because he really knows you. Our children. You know, only God, yes. Right? Even at 2 years old, only God. 20 years old, only God. no matter what age they are, only God can transform a person's life enough that his spirit can dwell. He's the one that can shape and completely change and transform individuals. Let the head of the church do what he does best. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 simply describes the Godhead of Christ. It says, in whose case the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they may not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. You see, one of the big problems of wrapping our heads around the Godhead of Christ is the God of this world. Satan says, I'm gonna blind your eyes, deafen your ears, so none of this makes sense. I will blind your eyes, and here's the tricky part about it, to make you think that you're in charge. Right? It's because get up every day, who picks off your clothing? Chances are you do, right? You dress yourself, you put the key in the car, you drive yourself to work, you go make money, you spend money. In other words, God gives you free will, and it gives the nuance of that you are in charge. But we're not. Get fired and you see how much you're in charge. Let your car break down in the middle of the road. See how much you get. You follow me? Let your bank account go to zero and see how much you're in charge. Right? In other words, circumstances in life begins to say, oh, well, there's someone bigger than me and there's someone that I need to hope and trust in that is way bigger than me. Right? Have marriage conflict, family conflict, right? All these things that stir us and start confusing us, that start, honestly, I personally believe, begin to enlighten us. Sometimes we need a little turbulence in our lives for us to look up and say, okay, God, you're in charge. I'm not. Help. It has a unique way of bringing light to the gospel of the glory of Christ. And the unspoken part of the glory of the gospel is Christ is God. Because he's the only one who could pull such a thing off as being the first risen from the grave. Amen? So again, the head of the church, he's our deliverer, he's our God. Number three, we find in verse 17, the head of the church holds everything together. I don't know about you, but again, live life long enough, stuff just starts falling apart, even your body. Things just starts decaying. Things just starts being dysfunctional and disorderly and things like that, which is so much like the church. Can you imagine people from different races, cultures, socioeconomic classes getting together and being one? That's chaos. Then you add language barriers in there. Chaos. I mean, think about it. You could be a husband, wife, just grossly love each other, right? And get married, and guess what happens? Chaos pops off. And then you need someone to come in to hold it together. And that's what he does individually to each household in the body of Christ. He holds us all together. He holds every individual heart and every individual home together. He supernaturally does that. And that's why if you dig deeper here in verse 17, the words hold together means to bring or to band all things together. To put together by way of composition. To unite parts in a whole. Only God can take a guy from Compton, California, and a young lady from Georgia in the South who ran around barefoot in a pond and things like that. And here I am, like never taking my shoes off at all, come together and become one. It's, you know, I'm the baby of eight. She's the only child. How does that even navigate together? He holds it together. He's the only one who can hold it together. And that's the importance of understanding that, no, at the end of the day, there has to be this invitation of the head of the church in every situation. God, hold it together. God, you have given me now this organization, and I prayed and asked you to let me have my own business. Now, you know what happens? Stuff starts falling apart. Because wherever their people are, stuff is just going to fall apart. Well, they're not showing up on time. Then now you got to do two jobs. They're quitting on you every day. And then now you're worrying about who else am I going to, right? And it's like, wait, I didn't sign up for this. But yes, you did. You asked to be self-employed. But who's going to hold it all together? God gives you authority in an organization, right? More authority, more problems. Who's going to hold it together? God, send people from the north, south, east, and west of all nations and tribes and tongues. Who's going to hold that together? Only Christ and Christ alone. He's the one who can make all these different unique parts into a whole. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 through 3 lays it out how Christ, the head of the church, holds everything together. It says, God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also made the world. Again, affirming the Godhead of Christ. And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact, listen to what it says, the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. One of the greatest revelations I had in the context of God holding our marriage together was this. Was that I don't care how much I try to explain things to Lisa, I couldn't explain it good enough. I mean, I would try the illustrations and she'd look at me like, what in the world are you trying to say here to me? You know, I tried the Bible way. Meaning, what I mean this is that the Bible says. And some of you know that don't even work. But you know how it worked for me? I had to apply the Bible to myself and allow the word of his power to hold me together to give her time to become all that God wants her to be. You know how Lisa and I have tried our best to navigate adult children? God, we're going to hold on to the word for ourselves to give you time to allow our children to catch up with you. When you allow him and the authority of his word to just intrude your space and time and impact every area of your life, church, he does it better than any speech, any nuance, any form of communication that you're trying to communicate with anyone you're trying to reach into their soul. He's the only one who can. Because he's our deliverer, he's our God, and he holds everything together. Verse 18, here's our fourth point. The head of the church is the beginning. Why is that important? The word beginning means this, that which anything begins to be. He is the active cause. He is the origin. You know, one thing is for sure in life is that there's a lot of beginnings and also a lot of endings, right? In other words, you may want to begin to be a man or a woman who becomes more committed to Christ and more focused in your relationship with him. Well, the only way that you could begin to be focused on Christ is that you must allow him to begin in it all in you. He is the beginning of everything that you will ever go through. He is the origin of everything. That's why he can take a mess and make it out of a message. Because he has created everything. The scripture says that he has created vessels of unrighteousness and also vessels of righteousness. You say, well, is that fair? Sometimes it is necessary. Let me give you an example. Have you ever had something happen into your life, in your life, that it was unfair and it happened, but that very thing God used to ultimately get you to exactly where he was already trying to gently communicate you to be? That's a vessel of unrighteousness working for righteousness. Here's the funny thing. This happens to so many people. Fully engaged in the church, serving, committed, sold out, growing, and then we get, I like to affectionately call it, full of ourselves, and then we stop doing the things that got us there, like prayer, fellowship, community, right? Going to church, all these basics of the faith, right? We get full of ourselves, and then before you know it, we just kind of peel off, and we think we kind of know more than we really know. Then what we stop doing is we stop going to church, we stop fellowshipping with the guys, stop fellowshipping with the ladies. We're not as accessible. We used to pick up the phone quickly, but now we're like, oh, caller ID says, oh, that's her calling from church. We don't, right? And before you know it, we find ourselves off the beaten path. Then stuff like this happens. You have a tragedy in the family. And it's like, okay, now who do I call? Now, rightfully so, you should be able to plug right back into the church, and the church should immediately accept you because that's what the church is about, right? But why does it have to take that? Why does it have to take a loss of a job, a loss of a loved one, physical problems, emotional problems, right? Vessels of unrighteousness then becomes vessels of righteousness because it's now causing all things to work together for your good. I was talking to someone who had a huge drug problem. A friend, his relative, asked me to come talk to him, and it was affirmation to me, but a clear revelation of how God works in certain situations. Huge drug problem. He calls me, and as I'm talking to him, you could see that he still wasn't getting it. Almost like, yeah, I have this problem, but just excuse after excuse. And I said to him, which is really weird when it came out of my mouth, I said, when's the last time you thanked God for being a drug addict? He looked at me like, you looking at me like, what do you mean? I said, because let's be honest, you wouldn't be sitting here with me unless you were a drug addict. He looked at me, he says, you know, you're absolutely right. And he began, now the veil began to be torn. He says, because I was arrogant, self-centered, successful. He went down a list of things. He says, I had no reason to call you and be here and ask for help until I was broken. So you know what we did? We got on our knees, and I said, I want you to pray and ask God and thank God for being a drug addict. Not, okay, God, I'm thanking you so I can keep on being a drug addict, but thank you for allowing me to get to a point of desperation that I need you. The Lord transformed his life, turned away from drugs completely. And the Lord began to remind me, in my life, and this is where the epiphany came. Because I remember there was a season of my life that I was like, God, can you just get rid of that? Can you get rid of that? Then I'll be good with you. I was like, God, if you could just help me with this, then I'll be faithful, then I'll be good, then I'll be this perfect Christian. I didn't say it that way, but that's kind of how I was feeling. right? Well, that temptation will never be there, so, right, I'll be good. And I'll never forget praying. And the Lord's just, you know, still small voice says, well, if I get rid of that, you won't need me anymore. So no. Because in your weakness, then you'll be strong. Or you could say it this way. In your weakness, you will remain exactly where you need to be. And that is at the foot of my cross. And I'm sure all of us have that kind of thorn in the flesh that is like, oh, if I can just get control, if I can. And he's like, nah, just can't, because you will become full of yourself. Just as Paul said, to prevent me from being full of myself, a messenger of Satan was sent to buffet me. Huh? Absolutely. Because Paul was saying, I was caught up in the third heavens. Who wouldn't write a book? Who wouldn't have a movie cast, right? Of I was in heaven. Oh, I'm writing a book. I'm telling everybody about it. I'm going to make a whole bunch of money. And it's going to be all about me because I was in heaven, in the third heavens, only where God is. Who wouldn't be full of themselves? So he says, to prevent me from becoming full of myself, a messenger of Satan was sent. Believe it or not, that is part of the sovereignty of God that a lot of people don't like to address. That he's in full control of all things at all times. But the other part of the sovereignty of God is he even causes those things to work out for our good. Because he's the beginning of everything. Which leads to our final point. Christ is the head of the ecclesia, the church. He is our completeness. You see, if you don't wrap your head and hearts around that he's in the beginning, that he is in full control, that he is God, that he is everything that you need, the deliverer, he is the one that is able to hold things together, then there will not be the humility that is needed to say to him that you are the only one that complete me. No matter how much education you have, which is so good, but there's not enough alphabets that you can add to the end of your name to complete you. Today, you may be single and just hoping that you get married one day and knight in shining armor comes to sweep you off your feet, or that wonderful woman you walk up and you say, wow, that is her. Ooh, and she's glowing and everything, right? But get married and you still figure out and find out how incomplete you are. Matter of fact, I believe marriage is one of those, marriage and having children kind of shows you, it's like, I'm like really, 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 really incomplete. Because the thought and the hope is, I get married and she fulfills me. Then you realize how much she doesn't. Then what do? Most of the time we act it out. We get upset with her because she's not doing this, she's not doing that, because she is not created to complete you. Children are not created to complete you. They're not. Again, you want R3? You'll see how incomplete you are. I mean, you ask any parent, yeah, praise the Lord, thank you, but my children are exposing areas in my heart that I didn't know I had. Again, get that favorite job. You'll have that job and you'll run into somebody on that job that says to you and tries to convince you that maybe you need to move on to another job. Because it's not the job that would ever complete you. All fullness dwells in him. The word fullness means this. It relates to the body of believers as that which is filled with the presence, power, agency, riches of God and of Christ. There's this abundance, and listen to what it says. All the completeness dwells in him. Some of you know what I'm talking about, that you've chased after, and you get there, and it's like, is this it? Yes, this is it. Because completeness is found only in Christ and Christ alone. That's why we gather. Yeah, it's sweet to have relationships with people in the church and connect with people in the church. But at the end of the day, it should be we're gathering because we need more of him. We need more of him. We need more of him. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19 through 23 expresses this about the completeness of Christ. What is the boundless greatness of his power toward us who believe? These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ. When he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things in subjection under his feet and made him head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness. This word fullness is the same word that we were looking at prior to in Colossians. It says, of him who fills, the word fill means now to furnish liberally and to ratify his promises. In other words, he will fill you and furnish you completely. Completely. And he will fulfill and ratify all of his promises on the inside. That's his promise. And I want to end with this prayer that is also found in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. If you could bow your heads with me. And as I pray this, can you also pray this for you and for us as a church? In Ephesians, it starts out by saying, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. There's about six things that we want him to grant us today. If we can just offer these up in prayer. Lord, please strengthen us on the inside through the power of your Holy Spirit of Christ. Lord, please root us and ground us in your supernatural love. Verse 17. Verse 18 and 19, Lord, please help us completely understand the magnitude of Christ's love. Verse 19 as well, Lord, help us find our completeness in God alone. Lord, please work through us beyond what we can ever imagine. And lastly, Lord, please receive all the glory forever and ever into the next generation. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us here at Commitment Online, a place for all nations. If you're ever in the Philadelphia, Delaware, or South Jersey region, we hope to see you in person. But for now, please tune in next week here at Commitment Online.